Exodus chapter 2. And there went a man of the house of Levi, this would be Amram, and took a wife, a daughter of Levi. And the woman conceived and bare a son, and when she saw him that he was a goodly child, she hid him 3 months. Now this isn't talking about the natural affection a mother has for her child. This goodly child in the Hebrew is Tov. It's a Strong's word, H2896. And it means good, pleasant, beautiful. But in the Septuagint, it's Astios Todios, and it means goodly to God. Let's go to the book of Hebrews, chapter 11, verse 23. By faith, the faith of Amram, Moses' dad, Moses, when he was born, was hid 3 months of his parents, because they saw he was a proper child, proper in God's eyes, and they were not afraid of the king's commandments. And why weren't they afraid? Well, because Romans 10:17, faith, the faith of Amram, cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So the only way Amram and his wife could know that Moses was proper or goodly in God's eyes is through some divine revelation from God himself. So let's go back to Josephus. And remember, we just read in chapter 1 how the Egyptians' sacred scribes prophesied about the coming of Moses. A man whose name was Amram, one of the nobler sort of the Hebrews, was afraid for his whole nation, lest it should fail by the want of young men to be brought up hereafter, because the male infants were being killed. And he was very uneasy at it, his wife being then with a child, and he knew not what to do. Hereupon he betook himself to pray to God and entreat him to have compassion on those men, those male babies, who had nowise transgressed the laws of his worship, and to afford them deliverance from the miseries they at that time endured, and to render abortive their enemies' hopes of the destruction of their nation, the Hebrew nation. Accordingly, God had mercy on him and was moved by his supplication, and he stood by him in his sleep and exhorted him not to despair of his future favors. Know therefore that I, God speaking, shall provide for you all in common, that's the whole Hebrew nation, what is for your good, and particularly for thyself what shall make thee famous. For that child, out of dread of whose nativity or whose birth the Egyptians have doomed the Israelite children to destruction, shall be this child of thine. God is telling Amram the child that the Egyptian scribes prophesied about is his child, and he shall be concealed from those who watch to destroy him, the Egyptians, particularly the Egyptian midwives. And when he is brought up in a surprising way under Pharaoh's own roof, he shall deliver the Hebrew nation from the distress they are under from the Egyptians. And God continues, his memory, or the memory of him, shall be famous while the world lasts. And so far it's been 3,400 years and still counting. And this not only among the Hebrews, but foreigners also. All which shall be the effect of my favor to thee and to thy posterity. He shall also have such a brother, and this is speaking of Aaron, that he shall himself obtain my priesthood, and his posterity shall have it after him till the end of the world. And of course, this is speaking of Jesus. So just like we saw when we studied the Gospel of Matthew, how that Jesus is the direct descendant of King David, we saw in the book of Luke how Jesus is also a direct descendant of Aaron, the brother of Moses. So now we know that the Lord God himself, in a vision, told Amram all the great things that he had in store for his unborn son, and no doubt he in turn told his wife. Let's go back to Exodus chapter 2, pick it up at verse 3. And when she could not longer hide him, she took him for an ark of bulrushes, and dabbed it with slime and with pitch, and put the child therein, and she laid it on the flags by the river's brink. And his sister, this is Miriam, stood afar off to witness what would be done to him. In other words, to see what God had planned for him. And the daughter of Pharaoh came down to wash herself at the river, and her maidens walked along the river's side. And when she saw the ark among the flags, she sent her maid to fetch it. And when she had opened it, she saw the child, and behold, the babe wept. And she had compassion on him, and said, "This is one of the Hebrew children." Then said his sister Miriam to the Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and call to thee a nurse of the Hebrew women, that she may nurse the child for thee?" And Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Go." And the maid went and called the child's mother, and that would be Jochebed. And Pharaoh's daughter said unto her, "Take this child away and nurse it for me, and I will give thee thy wages." So I'm going to pay you to nurse your own child. And the woman took the child and nursed it. And the child grew, and she brought him unto Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son, and she called his name Moses. So notice that Moses is an Egyptian name. And she said, "Because I drew him out of the water." Let's go to the book of Acts, chapter 7, verse 22. "And Moses was learned in all the wisdom of the Egyptians, and was mighty in words and deeds." So, now let's return to Josephus and get a glimpse of these mighty words and deeds. "Now Moses' understanding became superior to his age, nay, far beyond that standard, and when he was taught, he discovered greater quickness of apprehension than was usual at his age, and his actions at that time promised greater when he should come to the age of a man. So his potential seemed endless. God did also give him that tallness when he was but 3 years old, as was wonderful. Not a physical height, this means that his understanding was above all his peers. And as for his beauty, there was nobody so unpolite as when they saw Moses, they were not greatly surprised at the beauty of his countenance. Nay, it happened frequently that those that met him as he was carried along the road were obliged to turn again upon seeing the child, that they left what they were about and stood still a great while to look on him. For the beauty of the child was so remarkable and natural to him on many accounts that he detained the spectators and made them stay longer to look upon him." And this might help explain why Pharaoh's daughter was so taken by him. "He was therefore educated with great care, so the Hebrews depended on him and were of good hopes great things would be done by him because of the prophecies concerning him. But the Egyptians, because of their prophecies concerning him, were suspicious of what would follow such his education. Yet because if Moses had been slain, there was no one, either akin or adopted, that had any oracle on his side for pretending to the crown of Egypt, and likely to be of greater advantage to them, they abstained from killing him." So the prophecies about Moses and his wisdom was known by both Egyptians and Hebrews, and both nations had placed their hope in him. And although the Egyptian seers knew he would be Egypt's only hope for a future, they also know that he would be instrumental in bringing down Egypt. Let's continue in chapter 10 of Josephus. "Now the Ethiopians, who were next neighbors to the Egyptians, made an inroad into their country, which they seized upon, and carried off the effects of the Egyptians, who, in their rage, fought against them, and revenged the affronts they had received from them. But being overcome in battle, some of them were slain, and the rest ran away in a shameful manner, and by that means saved themselves. Whereupon the Ethiopians followed after them in the pursuit. And thinking that it would be a mark of cowardice if they did not subdue all Egypt, they went on to subdue the rest with greater vehemence. And when they had tasted the sweets of the country, they never left off the persecution of the war, and as the nearest parts had not the courage enough at first to fight with them, they proceeded as far as Memphis and the sea itself, while not one of the cities was able to oppose them." The Egyptians, under this sad oppression, betook themselves to the oracles and prophecies, the sacred scribes, and when God had given them this counsel to make use of Moses the Hebrew and take his assistance, the king commanded his daughter, this is Moses' stepmom, to produce him that he might be the general of their army. Upon which, when she, Moses' stepmom, had made him, the king, swear he would do him, Moses, no harm, she delivered him to the king and supposed his assistance would be of great advantage to them. She withal, or in addition, she reproached the priests who, when they had before admonished the Egyptians to kill him, to kill Moses, was not ashamed now to their own want of his help. Just like a mother. So Moses, at the persuasion both of Thermuthis, his mother, his stepmother, and the king himself, cheerfully undertook the business. I'm sure by this time Moses was quite aware of the prophecies concerning him, and even started to embrace this role. And the sacred scribes of both nations, the Egyptians and the Hebrews, were glad, those of the Egyptians, that they should at once overcome their enemies, the Ethiopians, by his valor, and that by the same piece of management Moses might be slain. And those of the Hebrews, that they should escape from the Egyptians, because Moses was to be their general. And Moses prevented the enemies, the Ethiopians, and took and led his army before those enemies were apprised of his attacking them. For he did not march by the river, but by land, where he gave a wonderful demonstration of his sagacity. When he had therefore proceeded thus on his journey, he came upon the Ethiopians before they expected him. And joining battle with them, he beat them and deprived them of the hopes they had of success against the Egyptians, and went on in overthrowing their cities, and indeed made a great slaughter of these Ethiopians. So I figure that Moses at this time had to be in his 20s or early 30s, somewhere around his peak fighting years. So through the Jewish historian Josephus, we get to see just a tiny glimpse of who Moses was and of his mighty words and deeds. Let's go back to Acts chapter 7. And when he was full 40 years old, it came into his heart from God to visit his brethren, the children of Israel. So Moses is starting to follow or embrace his destiny. And seeing one of them suffer wrong, he defended him and avenged him that was oppressed and smote the Egyptian. For he supposed his brethren would have understood how that God by his hand would deliver them, because of all those prophecies. But they understood not. Now let's return to the book of Exodus chapter 2. Pick it up at verse 11. And again, notice God is driving all of this. And it came to pass in those days when Moses was grown that he went out unto his brethren and looked on their burdens. And he spied an Egyptian smiting in Hebrew one of his brethren. And he looked this way and that way. And when he saw that there was no man, he slew the Egyptian and hid him in the sand. He buried him. And when he went out the second day, behold, two men of the Hebrews strove together. And he said to him that did the wrong, "Wherefore smitest thou thy fellow?" And he said, "Who made thee prince and judge over us? Intendest thou to kill me as thou killest the Egyptian?" And Moses feared and said, "Surely this thing is known." Now when Pharaoh heard these things, he sought to slay Moses. But Moses fled from the face of Pharaoh and dwelt in the land of Midian, and he sat down by a well. Now Moses didn't flee Pharaoh because he feared him. He fled to seek the Hebrew God. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 11, verse 24. By faith, Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures of Egypt, for he had respect unto the recompense of the reward. By faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. Let's go back to the book of Exodus, chapter 2, verse 16. Now the priest of Midian had seven daughters, and they came and drew water and filled the troughs to water their father's flock. And the shepherds came and drove them away. But Moses stood up and helped them, this battle-proven warrior, and watered their flock. And when they came to Reuel, their father, underline that, Reuel means friend of God, and it's his proper name, the name that his daughters knew him by. He said, "How is it that ye are come so soon today?" And they said, "An Egyptian delivered us out of the hand of the shepherds, and also drew water enough for us, and watered the flock." And he said unto his daughters, "And where is he? Why is it that ye have left the man? Call him, that he may eat bread." And Moses was content to dwell with the man, and he gave Moses Zipporah, his daughter. And she bare him a son, and called his name Gershom. That's their firstborn, for he said, "I have been a stranger in a strange land." Now Reuel was a Midianite priest. So he and his daughters were Midianites, and the Midianites were direct descendants of Abraham through his second wife Keturah. Let's go to Genesis chapter 25, verse 1. Then again, Abraham took a wife, and her name was Keturah, and she bare him Zimram, and Jokshan, and Medan, and Midian, and Ishbak, and Shua. Now let's go to the book of Numbers real quick. Numbers chapter 12, verse 1. And Miriam and Aaron spake against Moses because of the Ethiopian women whom he had married, for he had married an Ethiopian woman. Now, some of our Bible teachers, because of this one verse, mistakenly claim that Reuel and his daughters were Ethiopians living in the land of Midian. But clearly they were not. Reuel was a Midianite priest. They were Midianites, a descendant of Midian. But, according to Josephus, Moses did marry an Ethiopian woman when he was younger, during his service to Pharaoh, to ensure that he was victorious in the Ethiopian war. But here he had left Egypt and Pharaoh behind, and he is now in the service of God. Let's return to Josephus one last time. Tharbis was the daughter of the king of the Ethiopians. She happened to see Moses as he led the army near the walls and fought with great courage. And admiring the subtlety of his undertakings and believing him to be the author of the Egyptian success, she fell deeply in love with him, and upon the prevalency of that passion, sent to him the most faithful of all her servants to discourse with him about their marriage. He thereupon accepted the offer on condition she would procure the delivering up of the city, and gave her the assurance of an oath to take her to his wife, and that when he had once taken possession of the city, he would not break his oath to her. No sooner was the agreement made, but it took effect immediately. And when Moses had cut off the Ethiopians, he gave thanks to God and consummated his marriage and led the Egyptians back to their own. Let's go back to the book of Exodus, verse 23. And it came to pass in process of time that the king of Egypt died, and the children of Israel sighed by reason of the bondage, and they cried, and their cry came up unto God by reason of the bondage. And God heard their groanings, and God remembered his covenant with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob. And God looked upon the children of Israel, and God had respect or compassion unto them.